Good afternoon, everyone. If you could take a seat or a piece of floor or find a way to see the podium, this is an amazing gathering. My name is Catherine Newman. I'm the provost here at UMass and just delighted to see an audience here to hear about a very important topic. How often do you see a crowd like this assembled to talk about serious issues in economics? It does not happen every day, and we are thrilled to death. I'm going to ask the chair of the economics department, Michael Ash, to introduce this afternoon's speaker. But I want to say that he's a particularly appropriate person to deliver this introduction because he and his colleagues, Tom Herndon and Robert Pollan, exemplify what it means to be an economist whose work matters in the world. Many of you will know about their remarkable paper, Does High Public Debt Consistently Stifle Growth? A critique of Reinhardt and Rogoff, which made the news all over the world and challenged some very long-held views about the relationship between debt and growth. He has been the chair. Yes, Joe Buckle. Rock star in training. He has been chair of the economics department since 2011. And along with his colleagues, represents a tradition in economics which is not seen all over the globe, especially not in Chicago circles. So we are particularly delighted to have this fantastic heterodox economics department. I can't think of a better context in which to hear this afternoon's speaker. So I give you Michael Ash.
Thank you very much, Provost Newman, for your introduction. Welcome, colleagues, students, and guests. This afternoon, Professor Thomas Piketty will deliver the 2014 Gamble Lecture of the UMass Amherst Department of Economics. The annual Gamble Lecture features a prominent economist. Previous speakers in this series have included 8 Nobel Prize winners, including George Akerlof and the late Eleanor Ostrom, as well as other leading lights in the field, including Barbara Bergman, Alan Blinder, Marianne Ferber, and John Kenneth Galbraith. The Philip L. Gamble Memorial Lectureship Endowment was established by Israel Rogosa, class of 1942, and other family and friends, in memory of Philip Gamble, a member of the UMass Economics faculty from 1935 to 1971, who chaired the department from 1942 to 1965. And that's almost a quarter of a century, I note for my fellow chairs in the audience. We say every year that Professor Gamble was beloved by his students. After I met one of them, class of 1968, who 45 years later could describe regular class dinners at Professor Gamble's house in town, I better understood how Gamble's commitment to students had earned that love. This afternoon, we are honored by the presence of Marty and Elizabeth Rogosa. Israel's nephew Marty is a 1979 graduate of the Eisenberg School of Management and the steward of our Philip Gamble Memorial Lectureship Endowment. Elizabeth is a 1988 zoology graduate. Welcome and thank you very much for coming. The Gamble Lectureship is also supported by the Charles L. and Martha S. Gleason Fund. Charles and Martha were economics graduates in 1940 and 1942. Both are now deceased. There are many people at UMass who made this event possible, and the economics department is grateful to all of them. I'd like to single out for particular mention Nancy Lattenville of the economics department. And Jessica Dysack and James Mallett of the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences. They worked very hard to make this event possible. Our Gamble lecturer and distinguished guest, Professor Thomas Piketty, is a native of Paris, France. Thomas earned a master's degree in mathematics at the École Normale Supérieure. Then, fortunately for us, he turned to the social sciences. In 1993, after completing his PhD in economics at the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales and the London School of Economics, through a European doctoral program in economics, Thomas was appointed at MIT. But he decided, and my apologies to our diehard Hub fans, that the charms of Paris surpass even those of Boston and Cambridge. Thomas is now professor of economics both at AS and at the new Paris School of Economics, of which Thomas was founding director in 2005 through 2007. The motto of the Paris School of Economics is La science économique à la service de la société, rendered elegantly in English as economics serving society, a far more healthy configuration than the inverse construction apparently taught in many economics departments. Economics serving society is a sentiment we share at UMass. Thomas is the author of more than 10 books and 50 articles that have revolutionized our understanding of the history and state of inequality, both internationally and domestically for many advanced economies. For data aficionados in the audience, and I suspect that there may be a few, the fruit of this research is publicly available in the World Top Incomes Database, which Thomas co-founded. For the rest of you, let me translate World Top Incomes into the term which Thomas coined and which has galvanized a global reexamination of economic and social priorities, the 1%. It is no mean feat to examine the extreme upper tail of the income distribution. Among other things, very rich people don't like being measured. As an empirical economist, I am awed by Thomas' meticulous research across times and places, which has painted a new picture of the form and evolution of wealth generation and income distribution as both an economic and political process. Thomas' extraordinary book, Capital in the 21st Century, elegantly presents these arguments. Jane Austen and Honoré de Balzac share the stage with order statistics and capital income ratios, as well as with the Ancien Régime, the Belle Époque, the New Deal, the Trente Glorieuses, and the Great U-Turn. Professor Piketty has received many recognitions and awards, including most recently the 2013 Yrjö Jansson Prize of the European Economic Association. I expect that there is both more brilliant analysis and further recognition to come. Before I turn over the floor, let me remind you that all are welcome to join the economics department for a reception in this room following the lecture and questions and answers. Now please join me in welcoming the 2014 Gamble Lecturer at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, Professor Thomas Piketty.
Thanks a lot, Michael and Catherine. I'm very glad to be here at Amherst. I should first apologize for my English, which, as you can see, sounds a lot like French, but I hope you can still understand me. I'm very glad finally to discover UMass Amherst, which I had heard about this place for a very long time, and I've known Sam Bowles in particular for a long time, who has been an important, very important figure in the economics department, and I'm very glad to have this opportunity today to discover the place and to give this lecture. So in this lecture, I'm going to talk about my book, Capital in the 21st Century. So this presentation is going to be based on the book. So let me tell you quickly what this book is about. So this book came out in France exactly 1 year ago. It came out in English language last March. And this is really what I've tried to do in this research is to study the global dynamics of income and wealth inequality in over 20 countries since the 18th century. So this is, in my view, this is primarily a book about the history of income and wealth distribution. And so in a way, the title is a bit misleading because I sort of pretend that I talk about the future, but to be honest, I am much better at analyzing the past than the future. And I try at the end of the book, in part four of the book, I try to draw conclusions for the future, but let me be very clear about the fact that you can disagree with all of my conclusions and still be interested in the historical narrative that's proposed in part one, two, and three of the book. So most of the book is really about an historical narrative. It's trying to make accessible to everybody a large body of historical data that has been collected over the past 15 years with many other scholars. So let me also make very clear that although the book is single author book, the data that I present, I could never have collected it by myself. So I started working on the long-run evolution of income and wealth distribution in France about 15 years ago. And then I was very fortunate to meet Tony Atkinson, Emmanuel Saez. So Tony wrote in particular about the case of Britain and many other countries with Emmanuel Saez, who's at Berkeley. We've been working on the evolution of income inequality in the US, and Emmanuel has worked on many other countries as well, including Canada and Japan. With Facundo Alvaredo, we've been working on Argentina and Spain, with Abhijit Banerjee on India, with Nancy Chan on China. And, you know, I cannot quote everyone, but this is really a collective data collection project, and this is continuing. So this book is just a photography of the data set at one point in time, but we put new data online almost every month or even every week, and this will continue to be extended to more and more countries. So in what I guess in the book there's really two set of data that I put together. One that is about income distribution, income inequality, and the other one that was collected more recently, in particular with Postel Wiener, Rosenthal, Gabriel Zucman, and others, which is more about wealth and the evolution of wealth inequality. And to a large extent, what the book is trying to do is to try to shift the attention from rising income inequality to rising wealth inequality, because I think in the long run, wealth inequality might be even more important than income inequality. But of course, the two are related. Wealth, to a large extent, is accumulation from saving and out of income. So rising income inequality, rising wealth inequality are very related. But wealth is a more complicated object than just saving out of income, because you also have inherited wealth that was not saved, or at least not by the current generation. You also have natural resources, oil, that were not saved by anyone, but which matter a lot for the distribution of world property. So it's and the concentration of wealth is always a lot more extreme than the concentration of income, so it creates even more tensions and political tensions about, you know, what's fair and what's not, and what's justified and what's not justified. So the book is trying to shift the attention from income to wealth inequality, but it really deals about the try to articulate the two in a consistent manner. So let me try to describe very quickly the kind of data that I use, first for the income database and then for the wealth part of the database. So in this presentation, I will present some results from part 2 and 3 of the book. All graphs and series are available online. I'm sorry that I cannot put the book online yet, but you know, I'm sure at some point it will be online. Maybe it is already. Anyway, the graphs are all online, and this will give you a good sense of the material that's in the book. So let me start with the first part of the database, which is the World Topicon database. So this is also available online. So the countries in red are the countries that are already in the database, and the countries in blue are about to enter the database. Although this screenshot is not completely up to date, and for instance, Korea, we put it online a few weeks ago, so it should be late, and it's not. Not even mentioned. So it's not completely up to date. So what being in the database means is that we try to collect all the historical data that we have on income inequality. So usually the oldest data source on income comes from the income tax. So the income tax was created in the US in 1913. In France, it was adopted in the summer of 1914, so exactly one century ago. And this was adopted really, in the case of France, not to pay for schools, but to pay for the war. Finally, the French Senate accepted in July of 1914 to vote income tax to pay for the war. And it's very sad. It would have been nicer to adopt it for other reasons, but this is part of the story. Now, in some countries, it was adopted a bit earlier, like in Japan or many German states, it was adopted in the 1880s, 1890s. And in some countries, it was a bit later, like in India, it was implemented in 1922 by the British. So in many countries between 1900 and 1920, we have the creation of the income tax, which means that we have data on income. So it's important to realize that taxation is always more than just taxation. It's also a way to produce legal categories, statistical categories, and it's also a way to produce a source of information about society so that at least we better know what's going on, and then we can possibly adapt the policies, adapt the tax rate, but if we don't even know what's going on, it's difficult to have a quiet discussion about this issue. It's always difficult to have a quiet discussion about inequality, but if we can have a more informed discussion, at least maybe that can be an improvement. So let me show you an example of what we get from this data set, which is relatively well known now, which is the evolution of income inequality in the United States. So this is a very simple indicator of inequality, which is the share of total primary income. So this is total pre-tax market income, labor income and capital income, going to the top 10% income holders. Okay? And so in fact, the first economic, and you can see this very big decline in inequality in the first part of the century, and a very large increase in the recent decades. So the big decline is exactly what Kuznets found in the 1950s. So in fact, all what we've been doing in this database is really to extend this pioneering work of Kuznets to many more countries and to a longer period. And you can see that having a longer period changes quite a bit the general picture. So when Kuznets wrote in the 1950s, so Kuznets was an American economist, a Ukrainian-born American economist, who first computed the first GDP national income series for the United States in the interwar for the interwar period. And then the next step was to compute the first series on income distribution. So after computing the national income for the entire country, Kuznets thought, okay, I'm going to use the income tax data starting in 1913 with the creation of the income tax until 1948, because he was writing around 1950, and I'm going to compute how the share of national income going to the top 10%, which was approximately the fraction of the population paying the income tax in the US in the interwar period, how this has changed over time. And he came with a very good news, which was a big reduction of inequality. So when you read Kuznets himself, it's clear that he was very much aware that this had a lot to do with the Great Depression, with World War II, particular wage compression policy during World War II, very sharply progressive tax that were put in place at this same time period. But during the Cold War period, people were very happy to believe in a more sort of optimistic message and more universal reason why income inequality might decline. And so there was, at that time, starting in the 1950s, 1960s, there was this very optimistic interpretation of the so-called Kuznets curve, according to which income inequality in advanced stages of development tends to reduce naturally. And indeed, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, as you can see, you have a stable share going to the top, around one third of national income is going to the top 10%, which means that this is also a time of balanced growth. This means the fact that there's a stable share means that if you have a growth rate of GDP of 3% per year, everybody is getting the same growth rate. So it means that the average income of the top 10% is rising at 3%, the average income of the bottom 90% is rising at 3%. So it's balanced growth. It's sort of an ideal of post-war balanced growth, which you have in this stability. Now, starting around 1980, you have a very different picture. So where, as you can see, I think the orders of magnitudes are pretty astonishing. You go from about one third to almost one half of national income going to the top 10. And you have to ask yourself, how far is this going to go? Some people seem to believe that wherever it goes will be fine, that market forces will push up to the right equilibrium. But at some point, when the orders of magnitude are so strong, you have to ask yourself, is this going to stabilize right at 50%? Is this going to go to 60% of national income to the top 10, 70%? Where is this going to stop? By the way, here I stopped in 2010 because this is the data I had for the book, but we now have the data for 2011, 2012, and we're soon going to put the data online for 2013 with Emmanuel Saez. And right now it's even a bit above 50%. It's 51, 52%. So the curve is still going up. So you can see, you know, the large cyclical variation have to do with the business cycle. So, you know, when you are in 2001, this is not a very good time, you know, just with the crash of the internet bubble, this is not a very good time to exercise your stock option or to get a large bonus. But then in 2003, 4, 5, 6, 7, this is rising again. And you have the same thing with the current crisis. You know, in 2008, 9, this was not a good time to get big bonuses, but in 2010 and 11, 12, 13, although you don't see it on the graph, this is going up again. So, you know, at the end of the day, you know, the financial crisis per se and the business cycle per se doesn't seem to affect too much the long run evolution. So, you know, what are the forces behind this big rise in top income shares, particularly in the US? This is a very complex process involving different mechanisms, and I discuss it in a more detailed manner in the book. But let me say that, you know, the standard explanation among economists for a rise in inequality will be a change in the pattern of demand and supply for skills in relation to globalization. So, in other words, what will be the why would you have an increase in inequality, particularly strongly in the US? In Europe and Japan, you have also a rise in top income shares, but it is much less strong than what we have here. In other words, the explanation for this particularly big rise of inequality in the US would be that the supply of skills in the US has not increased sufficiently fast as compared to the demand or skill. In other words, you will need more investment in education, more people going to college, and a bigger rate of increase of the proportion of the population going to for longer education in order to reduce inequality. And indeed, you know, it is possible, you know, that's probably part of the explanation for the particularly big rise of labor earnings inequality in the US, has to do with the fact that maybe the US educational system is particularly unequal in the sense that you have very, very good top universities, top schools, and you know, the bottom 50% schools are maybe not so good. So that would be the standard explanation for a bigger rise in inequality, would be, you know, the pattern of supply and demand of skill is generating bigger skill premium for high skill as compared to lower skill. Now, that's probably part of the explanation, but that's what we have concluded with, in particular with my colleague Emmanuel Saez, is that this is not enough to explain why the rise in inequality has been so much concentrated at the very top. Because in fact, a very big part of this increase is due not only to the top 10%, but in fact, most of it is due to the top 1%, a very big part to the top 0.1%, and a skill-based story probably is not going to be enough. You know, it's not that the average skill of the top 1% or top 0.1% is a lot higher than the next 2 or 3 or 4%. So it's difficult to, if you want to explain why the rise in inequality has been so much concentrated, you really have to talk about why very top managerial compensation in very large companies has increased so much. And I think it will be a bit naive to imagine that, you know, when the top managers get a pay increase from $1 to $10 million per year, this simply reflects a rise in its relative productivity. You know, in some cases, you know, I think we shouldn't be too naive about, you know, the invisible hand of the market. You know, sometimes it is more like the grabbing hand that is able to put the right people in the right compensation committee. It's very difficult to observe individual productivity. You know, it's not written on your face. And when you are in a large company, you know, you're not going to operate the company without a chief financial officer for 10 years to see the impact on output. And even if you were to do that, you know, the corporate landscape would have changed so fast that you would not learn much. So there is a lot of imperfect information, and people who are in a position of power tend to exploit this informational asymmetry in their favor if you don't have strong institutions, governance rules that prevent them from doing so. And probably part of the reason why the increase in very top managerial compensation has been so spectacular in the US as compared to other countries is because, as I will show you at the end, the US is also one of the countries where you've had the biggest cut in top income tax rate, and which probably has changed enormously the incentives of top managers to try to put the right people in the right compensation committee and get such large pay increase. When the top tax rate in the 50s, 60s was 70-80%, of course you always want to have 1 million more, but you know, if 80% goes directly to the treasury, you are less motivated, and also your shareholders and subordinates might tell you, look, this is really costly. When you have a top tax rate of 30 or 40%, it's a very different kind of game. At least this is what we see in the data when we compare different countries over time and try to see where is it that managers increase their bargaining power. This seems to be a much more important effect than differences in the supply of skills. Anyway, this is the first big part of the book is really about trying to explain this evolution of top income shares. Now, as I said before, there is a second part of what the book is trying to achieve, which is to shift attention from rising top income to rising top wealth, and from income distribution to wealth distribution. And so I'm going to show you another graph which looks a lot like this one, but which in fact involves very different mechanisms and has a lot more to do with wealth than with income inequality. So this is a different graph which looks a lot like a U-shaped curve like this one, with a decline during World War I, World War II, the Great Depression, and an increase in recent decades. But in fact, these two graphs have very little to do with one another. And the first one was about income inequality in the US, whereas this one is about the long-run evolution of the capital income ratio. So what is the capital income ratio? This is the ratio between the total market value of wealth that here the private households own in a given country. So this includes real estate assets, business assets, financial assets, minus all debt, minus all liabilities. So when I talk about capital or wealth, it's always net wealth divided by national income. So if you want, this measures how many years of income people have on average in wealth. So in all European countries, Germany, France, UK, on average, people had between 6 and 7 years of income in wealth until World War I, which corresponds to a sort of very high wealth, what I call a patrimonial society, with a very large importance of wealth in the 19th century and up until World War I in European societies. So this was a time where wealth was important, not only in the statistics, but also in the literature. You know, the entire literature of the 19th century is full of wealth everywhere, in Balzac in particular, and it's not only because of the personal obsessions of the writers, which, Balzac was very indebted and he had to write novels all the time to pay back his own debt, but it was much more than that. It was that it played a powerful role in society, in particular inherited wealth was very important. So, when you have a bigger ratio of capital to income, it means there's more wealth relative to annual flow of new income in society, and in particular, it generally means that inheritance is going to be quite important. Now, following World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, there was a huge decline of the capital income ratio. And you can see that in the, starting in fact in the 1950s, you have a long process of recovery, which you can interpret as new capital accumulation. Now, let me make very clear that there is nothing bad per se in having a high capital to income ratio. And this does not necessarily mean high inequality. Now, it could be that you have a rising capital income ratio in a perfectly egalitarian society where everybody would have an equal share in the capital stock, because everybody will have his apartment or home of the same size, everybody will have the same stake in a gigantic pension fund. You know, you could imagine in theory a world where you have very high and rising capital income ratio, but with no inequality at all. So this is why this graph has really very little to do with this one, which was really about inequality. This one could, in principle, come without a rise in inequality. Now, in practice, however, the inequality of capital ownership is always much larger than the inequality of labor income. So when you have an increase in the capital income ratio, other things equal, this tends to come together also with an increase in total inequality. But this could be, you know, this could be different and different institutions, different rules. In particular, in order to spread wealth and access to property, could lead to a different outcome. So, you know, I will come back to this in a minute. But the fact that we have higher and higher capital income ratio is not necessarily bad. But it's important to be aware of that, because sometimes when you open an economic textbook, you are being told that the ratio of capital to income or capital to output is a constant. Now, as you can see. You know, this doesn't look like a constant, so you should be careful with economics textbook. You know, sometimes in economics, you know, when we don't know much about something, we just assume it's a constant, which, you know. So, of course, if you have only one data point, everything is a constant. In fact, there's no reason, there's no theoretical model that tells you that it should be a constant. In fact, the most standard model of economic growth, where you have substitution between capital and labor, tells you that any ratio could be an equilibrium, could be a steady state. And certainly in historical data, we see a lot of variation. And, you know, one big question is, again, where is this going to go? What are the consequences for the structure of society, the structure of the economy? And so these are the issues that I'm trying to document and explain in the book. Okay, so here are the three points that I will try to make in the rest of this conference. And, you know, this looks very organized, but I'm not so sure it will be able to do everything that's written here. So let me summarize each point so that at least you get a sense of what I want to say. So the first point, I already started to mention it. This is about, you know, what I call the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society, particularly in Europe and Japan. And this is an evolution. You know, the second curve that I have shown you is particularly strong in Europe and Japan, and it's less spectacular in the US. You have a little bit of the same evolution of wealth to income ratio in the US, but it's less spectacular. And in particular in Europe and Japan, wealth to income ratio seem to be returning to very high levels. And that's particularly true in low growth countries, particularly in countries with low population growth. So, you know, a big difference between Europe and Japan and the US is that historically, of course, population growth has been a lot bigger in this country. You know, so population in the US now is over 300 million. It used to be 3 million at the time of independence. So, you know, it's not the same country. France, you know, at the time of the French Revolution, it was already almost 30 million, and now it's 60. So, you know, it was divided, multiplied just by two, you know, in two centuries, it's very slow growth. You know, this is almost the same families, almost the same buildings. Well, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but you can see that, you know, it's completely different. And that's also the reason why, you know, I love America, and I certainly believe in American exceptionalism. At the same time, you know, I think it's quite unlikely that the population of the world will be multiplied by 100 in the next two centuries. So the lessons that one can draw from the history of capital accumulation and inequality in America are very specific and are difficult to generalize. And in a way, you know, France is a country with very slow population growth and even population stagnation in the 19th century, the first country, you know, to stop having babies. Now French have more babies than Germans and Italy, and apparently France is going to become more populated than Germany by 2050, which is something everybody is eagerly waiting for in France. But anyway, France in the 19th century already experienced population stagnation, which is something that, according to the United Nations, the entire planet is going to experience in the 21st century. So in that sense, I think the lessons from France and from a number of European countries and Japan, you know, are maybe more informative for the future of the planet than the lesson from a very, very high population growth country like the US. And, you know, even in the past centuries, the US have come from 100 million a century ago to 300 million today. Are you going to be 900 million one century from now? You know, maybe yes, maybe not. But whatever happens, will have a very strong impact on the ratio of capital to income, because the central intuition here is that when you have a slower growth, and in particular slower population growth, then wealth accumulated in the past can naturally become very important. In the extreme case where you have no growth at all, if you keep accumulating, you go to infinity. So in fact, you will never go to infinity, because at some point capital will become useless and people will stop accumulating. But you can go higher, for a given saving rate. You tend to accumulate a bigger quantity of wealth in a slow growth economy than in a country with much bigger growth and new population coming in all the time. So to the extent that in the very long run we will have population growth everywhere and possibly productivity growth, population growth slowdown everywhere and possibly productivity growth slowdown everywhere, this return of a patrimonial society can be relevant for the entire world. I'm going to come back to this in a minute. The second point I will try to make more quickly will be about the future of wealth concentration. And I will argue that one important force that determines the level of inequality of property in the long run is the gap between R and G, where R is the net of tax rate of return to wealth, and I will be more specific about that. And particularly the net of tax rate of return for large wealth portfolio, and G is the growth rate of the economy. And to the extent that R minus G will rise in the future, both because of population growth slowdown and growth slowdown in general, and also because of rising international competition to attract capital investment, which tend to lead to higher net of tax rate of return, then wealth inequality might reach or even become higher than 19th century levels. Of course, there are other possible evolutions, in particular, depending on the institutions and policies that we choose to adopt. So I'm certainly not saying this is the only solution. The last point, which I will deal much more quickly, will be about this new form of inequality, which to some extent has developed in the US in recent decades, where wealth inequality historically, as I was saying, has been less important in the US than in Europe. A century ago, wealth concentration in Europe was a lot bigger than in the US, partly for the reason I have mentioned. But recently, a new model of inequality has developed in America, with extreme inequality of labor earnings and, in particular, extremely high levels of top labor incomes. And what I will argue is that the winners of this model tend to argue that this is a much better model, that it's based on merit, it's based on productivity. But the evidence for the the relation between $10 million pay for a top manager and the productivity is not so clear. So I think this can become this new inequality model, particularly if it comes also with the development of higher levels of wealth inequality and the return of some form of patrimonial society, can be the worst of all worlds for the loser of the model, in the sense that they are losing ground, they are losing income shares, and at the same time they are being told that this is their fault, basically, that this is due to their low productivity. So at least in the novels of Balzac or Austin, nobody is trying to pretend that the servants are being servants because of their fault. They just happen to have no wealth, but nobody is trying to pretend that this is fair. Whereas this new form of inequality model is putting much bigger pressures in a way on the losers of the system. If this is part of the future, this is a bit troublesome. Going to try to make these three points, but I'm not sure how much I will make. So let me start with the first point. Let me, in fact, argue the return of a wealth-based society. So I'm not going to spend too much time on this. Let me show you, a couple of graphs so that we can have a more sort of concrete view of what's in the book. So this is the evolution of the ratio between capital, private capital, and income in a number of countries. So this includes the top eight developed economies: the U.S., Japan, Germany, France, U.K., Italy, Canada, Austria. So you can see, that you can see a number of things. First, this is a fairly chaotic evolution. You can see, for instance, Japan, between 1985 and 1990, where the ratio of private wealth to income goes from 5 years of income and wealth in 1985 to 7 years in 1990. Now, of course, this is due to a real estate bubble, to a very big increase in the price of capital assets. And very often, the short run, medium run, and sometimes even long run evolution in the ratio of capital to income have a lot to do with the movement in asset prices, which are notoriously unstable and which create a lot of fragility for our financial system, and at the same time, a lot of chaotic variation in the ratio of capital to income. So, you cannot get rich so fast simply by saving. Even with a Japanese saving rate, in order to accumulate 2 years of income in 4 years, you would need to have a saving rate of 50% per year. That's not possible. So now, in the longer run, what's interesting is that, although the timing are different, in particular because the bubbles in asset prices are different, you have a general upward trend, in pretty much every country. So these are only eight countries, but these are the top eight developed economies in the world. So that's about one half of world GDP. So that's an important part of the world. And you can see that in 1970, every country was between 2 and 3.5 years of national income in private wealth. And in 2010, every country is between 4 and 7. So there's clearly a general upward evolution, and which again contradict completely the view that this should be stable. Now, how can you explain this? So I already mentioned the growth slowdown part of the explanation, which is that with lower growth, you tend to accumulate more wealth. It's a lot more complicated. One important parameter is the rise of real estate prices, which has been an important part, not only in Japan between 1985 and 1990, but also throughout the period in many countries. This accounts for an important part of the evolution. Another part of the evolution which I would like to mention is that in many countries over this period, you have a transfer from public to private wealth. Okay, so let me compare this evolution of private wealth with the evolution of public wealth. Okay, so this is the private capital to national income ratio, and this is the public capital. So what is public capital? Well, this is defined in the same way as private capital, which is you take the assets, the real estate, the financial assets owned by the government, federal, state, local government, minus public debt. Okay, so usually we only talk about public debt, and we talk a lot about public debt these days, but we should also look at assets, both owned by the public and by the private. So as you can see, public capital in every country has been going down. So right now, if you take a country like the US or France or Germany, the net public capital is very close to zero because the public assets are comparable, according to the existing estimates, to the public debt. So it's about 100% of GDP for both, or 90% of GDP for both. So the difference between public assets and public debt is very close to zero. So this is why at the end of the period, most countries are close to zero. Now, in some countries, it could be negative. So you can see in Italy, it's largely negative, which means that even if the Italian government was selling all the public buildings, all the public schools, hospitals, it would not be enough to pay back the debt. In the US, in France, it would be just enough to pay back the debt. I'm not saying that's good news, but So in effect, you know, I'm not saying we should do that. You know, we will then have to pay rent to the owners of the school in order to use the public schools for our children, which will be a bit troublesome. But you should be aware of the fact that, in a way, this is already what we are doing when we pay, interest on the public debt, you know, which, you know, whether you pay rent on the public schools owned by private owners or interest to the public debt owners, which in effect own the public assets, since the total value of the public debt is comparable to the public assets, it's not entirely different. So anyway, what you have throughout the period is a decline in many countries in public assets through privatization in particular, and an increase in public debt. So if you have less public assets, more public debt, you have a general decline in public capital, and part of the increase in private capital can be accounted in this debt. So if you take the case of Italy, it is one of the countries where the decline in public capital has been the strongest, in particular because of a huge increase in public debt, and this is also the country where the increase in private wealth has been the strongest. Okay. And partly because the Italian household have been buying the public bonds and the privatized public assets by their government. Okay. So the two are very related. If there are other cases in the world that are even more extreme. If we were to look at this graph on public and private capital for Russia and for Eastern Europe, you know, you would see a huge decline in public capital, a huge increase in private capital. And you know, it's not that the Russian oligarchs have saved a lot. You know, it was just a transfer of assets from public to private. And so, what has happened in developed capitalist countries is a less spectacular form of this evolution, and that's an important part. Now, is this good news or bad news? Well, you know, some of it is bad news, but I would like to stress that there is also good news on this graph and more generally on my book, because you know, sometimes people seem to have a very pessimistic reading or even depressing reading of my book, and this makes me very sad because I have a much more optimistic character than what some people seem to believe. And in particular, so let me give you this piece of good news. The good news is that rich countries are rich. You know, it is their governments which are poor, which is a problem, which raises a number of problems. But in fact, you know, we talk a lot, you know, I don't know in the US, but certainly in Europe these days, we talk a lot about the public debt, and we always say, you know, we are going to leave to our children more public debt than ever, and we should be ashamed, and this is very bad. And so, of course, we should always be ashamed of what we do. But, you know, at the same time, it's important to realize that the increase in private wealth as a fraction of GDP has been much bigger than the increase in public debt as a fraction of GDP. So in other words, we are going to leave to our children more private wealth than ever, or at least for those who have wealth to leave. So of course, this raises issue of inequality, of distribution, of institution, of policies. But at least this means that the economic fundamentals are much better than what we typically imagine sometimes, in the sense that, you know, sometimes, you know, again, maybe that's particular in France or in Europe, but people in France, you know, believe that, you know, we only have debt, that we are being owned by the Emir of Qatar or the Bank of China or Californian pension fund sometimes, you know. But in fact, you know, European countries, you know, have never been as rich, not only in absolute terms, but even if we take the ratio of wealth to income, you know, we need to, as I showed you before, we need to return to the pre-World War I period to see such a high ratio of net wealth to income. So even after you take away all the debt, all the private debt, all the public debt, the net wealth has never been as large for a century. So, you know, it's difficult for the government to get at this wealth because of problems with fiscal cooperation, etc., etc. But the economic fundamentals are much better than we typically assume. So let me move on a little bit, and let me come to, I'm not going to present this, that will take us too long, but let me come to the future of wealth concentration and how wealth inequality in the long run might evolve. Now, if you look at the evolution of wealth concentration over the past century, what we see is a transition from what I call a classic patrimonial society, which, if you want, is a world of Austin and or Balzac or which you also have until, you know, until World War One. Until World War One, you have an extreme concentration of wealth with, you know, about 90% of the wealth for top 10% wealth holders, and basically the rest of the population has very little. Whereas today, you know, one century later, we have what I call in the book a patrimonial middle class. So in the book, I define, you know, these are very crude definitions, and I don't claim that these are the right words. You know, the choice of words is always complicated when we talk about inequality. But so here I use very precise statistical definitions so that at least we can make comparison over time across countries. So I distinguish between the top 10%, the bottom 50%, and the middle 40%, so the people who are not in the bottom 50% and who are not in the top 10. And this is what I call the patrimonial middle class. And the big difference, basically, between one century ago and today is that one century ago there was no middle class, in the sense that because 90% of the wealth would belong to the top 10, you know, the middle 40 will just be as poor as the poor. Whereas today, the bottom 50% is still very poor, you know, typically less than 5% of national wealth, and that would be more 2% in the United States. So it's, you know, but, you know, in European countries it's around 5%, so it's, you know, it's not that different. So the net wealth is very small. So, you know, some people in this group might have real estate, but they are mortgage who are sometimes bigger than the value of their real estate, or almost as big. The difference today is that the middle 40% own 20-30% of aggregate wealth, at the same time, this is much less than what the top 10% owns. So the top 10% today will own about 60% of national wealth in Europe and over 70% in the US. So the middle class, although they are four times, by this definition, four times more numerous than the top 10, they own two or three times as less. So, you know, you can always say that this is not enough, of course, but at the same time, a century ago, this was nothing at all. So this is a huge improvement in the sense that there has been a massive diffusion of wealth. So now you have a large group in society who, you know, people who are not very rich, but who are not completely poor, who own $100,000, $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 in net wealth, and, you know, who have accumulated something. Now, one of the big questions I'm trying to answer in the book is, how did it happen? Will it last? Will this patrimonial middle class expand? Will it shrink? So in the US, in the recent decades, you know, our knowledge of wealth inequality is imperfect. And, you know, one of the reasons why I would like to have a progressive wealth tax is because we would have better data and we would be better able to follow what's happening to wealth. And, you know, but I'm speaking seriously, without the income tax, we would know much less about income inequality than what we know. And because there is no annual wealth tax, and we only have wealth survey, we have wealth tax at death through inheritance, but it's only for a very small fraction of the population in this country, and, you know, death happens only one time in life, so you don't have a lot of information on wealth dynamics apart from this one time. But anyway, even if the data is imperfect, what we have suggests that the middle class share in the US has been trending downwards in a quite spectacular way, from about 30% to about 20% today. So it used to be almost 30% 30 years ago, and now it's closer to 22-23%. And I refer you to a recent paper by Saez and Zuckman, which was not available when I wrote this book, but I give estimates that are not too different, although their estimates are even more sort of alarming in terms of rising concentration of wealth. So anyway, how do we think about the long-run level of wealth inequality in society? This depends on many mechanisms, you know, the pattern of saving rate, of course, and the evolution of income inequality itself has a strong impact on the pattern of saving. So when you have a stagnation of median incomes, as we've had in the US over the past few decades, it's clear that you're not going to have a lot of saving and wealth accumulation. You're going to have a lot of accumulation of debt. And many people believe that this has, in fact, contributed to the accumulation of debt, which has itself contributed to make the financial system more fragile until the financial crisis of 2008. But there are other mechanisms apart from the pattern of savings that determine the long run evolution of wealth. And in particular, a very important mechanism, so I don't have time to show you all of this, but you can find them online. The important mechanism I would now like to emphasize is the following. Historically, we see that a big part of the historical decline in inequality was due to shocks. Now, the question is, apart from shocks, what forces determine the long-run level of wealth concentration? And what I'm going to argue now is that in a very large class of theoretical models, what you will find is that the steady state level of wealth concentration will be an increasing function of the gap between the rate of return and the growth rate. So let me be a bit more concrete. If you have a growth rate of 1% per year, so in other words, if output, wages, everything is growing, say, 1% per year, and if the rate of return to capital, so the rental income or the dividends or the interest or the profits coming from your capital, correspond to an average rate of 5% per year, what does this mean? Well, this means that if you have you start with wealth, then you can consume basically most of the return to your capital. In fact, you can exactly consume 4/5 of the return to your capital, and you only need to reinvest 1/5 of the 20% of the return to your capital to make sure that your wealth and the wealth of your family will rise as fast as the size of the economy and the average wealth of society. So of course, some families will consume more than that, some families will consume less than that, some families will have many children, some will have too few, some will die too late, some will die too early. The life of family is full of complications, and you always have wealth mobility, some family goes down, some family goes up. But what you can show is that for a given variance of these other shocks, when you have a bigger gap between R and G, inequality will tend to stabilize at a higher level. So it's not that inequality will rise forever. I've never said or written that inequality will rise forever. It will stop rising somewhere. But when you have a bigger gap, R minus G, then this will stabilize at a higher level and with less mobility and with more perpetuation of inequality across generation. Okay? So now in the future, because of growth slowdown and rising tax competition to attract capital, it could well be that the gap R minus G will rise. This will also depend on what you can do with the technology. So in particular, how much you can have different uses for capital. You probably all remember the announcement that was made by Amazon at the end of last year that they wanted to replace their delivery workers by drones, which many people thought it was a joke, but apparently it was not a joke. And other people said that Amazon is already treating their workers like drones, so it wouldn't make much of a difference. But in any case, that will be an extreme example of what economists will call capital labor substitution. And now, how much will it be the case in the future? Nobody knows. At this stage, certainly real estate capital or capital that's used in the energy sector is much more important than robots and this kind of extreme substitution between capital and labor. But in the future, nobody really knows how far this can go. So this will also have a strong impact on future value of the rate of return. And I'm certainly not pretending I know what's going to happen. But what I know is that small increase in the gap between R and G can easily lead to much higher wealth concentration than what we have today. So to give you an example of what I mean by this comparison by R and G, I'm going to conclude with this. I don't know how much time I have left. Maybe I have already... No? It's okay. Yeah. So let me show you a very concrete example of R bigger than G, if you want. So this is data from Forbes ranking of billionaires. So let me say right away that this is not particularly reliable data. But we have to do with what we have. We live in a sad time period in a way, because people have to read magazines to know about wealth. And I would prefer if people could buy IMF publications or Eurostat publication, but they will not find the information, in particular because the IMF for many years was against automatic transmission of bank information at the international level, was against a global registry of financial assets, which could have helped to get statistics on wealth internationally. So maybe one day, you know, we'll have more financial transparency and there will be public reliable statistics on wealth. But at this stage, you know, we have to do with what we have. And so what we have in particular are these rankings published by magazines. So here I start in 1987, because this is when the Forbes magazine in the US started publishing their global ranking of billionaires. So each year they have their list of everybody in the world who have more than $1 billion. So usually what people do with this data is just they say, okay, you have more and more billionaires in the world. But you know, at the same time, in a growing world economy, it's not too surprising that you have more and more billionaires. So what I do here is a bit more sophisticated, although very simple. I take a fixed fraction of the world population, so you know, the top 1 over 100 million, the top over 1 over 20 million, and I do it for other groups as well. And I look at how fast the average wealth of this group has been increasing over this time period. So of course, these are not the same people over time. You know, you have some people who go down, some people who go up, you have new billionaires from emerging countries. Back in 1987, the top of the ranking, you know, was not Bill Gates, it was actually Japanese billionaires, which everybody has forgotten. So you have people going down, people going up, and that's fine. But even if you have people going down, going up, you know, the average wealth of this group, in principle, in the long run, should rise approximately in the same proportion than the average wealth in the planet. You know, if we were in an equilibrium of the distribution of wealth, this is what we should have. Now, this is not at all what we have. You know, over this time period, you know, the top has been rising 3 to 4 times faster than the average, in the sense that, you know, this is rising at 6 to 7% per year. Whereas average wealth in the world has been rising at about 2%. So this is all in real terms, so after deduction of inflation, and average income has been rising at 1.4. World GDP has been rising at 3.3%. That's particularly because of China, particularly because of emerging countries. But you should be aware of the fact that world adult population has been increasing at 1.9% over this period. So that the per capita, per adult GDP or per adult income has been rising at only 1.4, you know, 3.3 minus 1.9. So that's very important to realize that a big part of the feeling of growth that we have in the world today still comes from the fact that we have a lot of population growth. So this is supposed to go to zero in the future, but we are not there yet. And even right now in 2014, world GDP is supposed to rise at about 3.2%, and half of it is population growth. And that's particularly due to aging in Asian countries, European countries, North American countries. But so at some point this is supposed to stop, but for now, you know, average income in the world over this period has only been rising at 1.4% per year. So average wealth has been rising a bit faster, 2.1%. That's because of the rise in the beta, in the wealth to income ratio that I've shown you before. So wealth is rising a bit faster than income. So average wealth is rising a bit faster than average income. But you can see that the top is rising 3-4 times faster. So how long is this going to continue? And how far is this going to go? You know, I don't know, but you can see, you know, if you do simple simulations, that this can go, you know, very far. If you continue to have the top rising 3-4 times faster than the average for three decades or 4 decades, you know, asymptotically the share of world wealth that will belong to billionaires will go to 100%. So I'm not saying this is going to go to 100%, but I think the you know, this can rise a lot. This can be a lot higher than what it is today. And you know, I think this should be something that everybody should be concerned about, and that, you know, we it's important to realize that there are no natural forces in this process that ensure that this will stop at a reasonable level in, you know, in any meaningful sense. And so why is it that the rate of return is particularly high for this large portfolio? Some of it is entrepreneurial wealth. Some of it has to do with I think, you know, financial deregulation has probably contributed to an increase in the inequality in access to high returns. So in other words, you know, more and more sophisticated financial products sometimes implies that, you know, for normal people or with low portfolio, you know, it's very difficult to get a return above 1 or 2%. But if you have access to very sophisticated financial products, financial derivatives, you can get return of, 6, 7, 8%. So just to give you an example of this, I thought you might be interested in the return to university endowments in the US. So I hope I'm not going to depress anyone here, but I know. But anyway, so the only reason why I look at university endowments is because I have a lot more data on university endowments than on the billionaire. Because, you know, the billionaire, you have the Forbes ranking, but you don't really have detailed information about the portfolio and the investment strategy. Whereas at least universities in the US, you know, they publish financial statements and you can put together this data. And so I did this computation with the financial statement. So you have 850 universities who have endowments. So these are the average real annual rate of return over a 30-year long period. So this is net of inflation and net of all management fees. Okay, so this is really the pure rate of return to capital. Now you can see that this is pretty high for everybody. So maybe this was a particularly good period. I'm not saying the future is going to be necessarily as high, but you know, it's so high that, you know, even if this goes down a little bit, this is really quite spectacular. And you can see that the bigger your initial endowment, the bigger your return. So what's the explanation for this? You know, it's very clear from the portfolio strategy that the bigger the return, the more sophisticated the financial investment strategy. So typically, these people, these endowments, you know, they don't have public debt. Okay, they have the financial derivatives or private equity. They have very very sophisticated financial products, in particular at the top of the list. Now, I think part of this is simply due to scale effects in portfolio management. Okay, so when you have a bigger initial endowment, you are able to spend to hire more people. So if you take the case of Harvard, so right now, so the Harvard endowment in 2010 was $30 billion. Now it's already 40, I think. Harvard is spending only 0.3%. of their endowment in management fees each year. But 0.3% of 30 billion is already almost 100 million. And so if you spend 100 million each year in wages, you know, you can hire a pretty big team of wealth managers, you know, even if they are paid well individually. And if this allows you to get a return of 10% rather than 6%, yeah, then it's definitely worth it. And at the end of the day, you know, this return of 10%, what I found particularly striking in this data is how big this is as compared to the gift made by former students. Okay, so the gift made by former students of Harvard University to Harvard endowment during this period represents less than an annual term, less than 1% of the endowment, and closer to 0.5% of the endowment. So this really is not relevant. Financially speaking, this is not relevant in the sense that the main reason why the endowment has gone from, you know, $3 billion in 1990 to 30 in 2010 has very little to do with gift of former students. So, you know, this is, as long as this is only for universities, maybe it is not too bad because Harvard is doing lots of useful things with the money. Well, sometimes they do strange studies from what I have heard, but as long as they invest the money in science, etc., we can say it's good for all of us. Also, you know, this can create problem with the inequality between universities in this country, which I'm sure you are all concerned with. But now, I didn't want to make a statement about universities. The point I want to take from this is that if you have this same mechanism at the level of private wealth holders and private billionaires, you can see that this creates a very powerful source of divergence in the wealth distribution that is really quite impressive. So in other words, you know, even if the gap between R and G is not that large on average, you know, even if the average rate of return to capital is not that much bigger than the growth rate, it could be that the rate of return to very large wealth portfolios is a lot higher. And this creates an amplification mechanism for wealth inequality, which, again, nobody knows how far this will go. You know, I cannot predict, are we going to stop exactly at this level of wealth inequality or not, but that's this can go quite far. So let me conclude by saying that the most rational response to this, of course, will be progressive taxation of income and also of wealth. First, this will be a way to produce data. We wouldn't have to read the Forbes ranking. But you know, I think data is not important just for scholars doing research. You know, I think data is important for society. You know, and if we want to know how we must change our tax rate and tax policy, you know, it would be very important to have a reliable public basis so that we know. You know, maybe the Forbes ranking are overestimating how far the top is going. Maybe they are underestimating. You know, it will be very surprising given that the growth rate at the top is 3 to 4 times bigger than the average if in fact it was the same. So, you know, when people are trying to deny the rise in wealth inequality, you know, they should publish their wealth rankings, but, you know, it seems very hard to believe. So anyway, progressive wealth tax potentially will be the best solution to solve this problem. Now, of course, there are other solutions. You know, inflation is a way to redistribute wealth. Now, the problem is that it doesn't always go in the right direction. But you know, this has been a very important way to redistribute wealth and certainly to get rid of large public debt in the past. You know, there are other ways. You know, there are countries like Russia, where the political power sort of tolerate extremely wealthy oligarchs as long as they don't do politics, and then when they start doing politics, they put them in jail. And you know, the Chinese government anti-corruption campaign these days tend to look a little bit similar. You know, this is another way to sort of regulate the distribution of wealth. But I think, you know, even the Chinese government is starting to realize that that this is not a very efficient way to regulate wealth, and that they are seriously thinking of introducing some form of property or wealth taxation, you know, in particular inheritance taxation, which they will need. So, is this going to happen? Let me, you know, conclude with a graph on the evolution of taxation. And you know, what I want you to take from this is that the entire history of income and wealth and taxation is unpredictable, and you know, things can change very quickly, much more quickly than what is commonly assumed. So here you have the evolution of the top income tax rate in 4 countries, US, UK, Germany, France. So you can see that the US and the UK, and in particular the US, is really the country that has invented progressive income taxation and that has used the highest level of income tax progressivity in the past century. So in particular, if you make the average between 1930 and 1980, the average top income tax rate in the US will be 82%. You know, sometimes it was 90%, sometimes it was 70%, on average it was 82%. That's not taking into account the state income tax, that's only the federal top income tax. And, you know, apparently this did not destroy American capitalism. And if anything, the growth rate in the 50s, 60s, 70s were higher than what they've been since 1980, where the growth performance has been in fact quite mediocre in the recent period with the lower top rate. So, you know, these things can change a lot. 1 century ago, many people would have said, so there was no income tax 1 century ago, or a little bit than a century ago, or very low tax rate in Britain where there was an income tax. And many people, in particular in this country, you know, would have said that the progressive income tax will never happen, that the constitution made it impossible to happen, and then, you know, things happen. You know, so things happen all the time which are not predicted initially. And so, you know, I think the collective representations of inequality and what's justified and what's not justified in terms of inequality can change very fast. And certainly, one of the key reasons why income tax progressivity became so high in the US in the 1920s. And you have the same evolution for the inheritance tax, because this is you can see again that this is the US and the UK that have had the biggest level of tax progressivity, you know, with top tax rate of 70-80% for large inheritance, much bigger than in Germany and France. That's partly because in Germany and France, the war destruction had done a lot of the redistribution, so there was less of a need for taxation. But I think it's more than that. It's also that in the US, a century ago, you know, there was a growing concern about inequality and the view that the ideal, egalitarian ideal of the pioneers was very far, and that there was a need for a strong public interventions to try to avoid excessive level of inequality. And, you know, I think this kind of reaction can happen again in the future. Let me just conclude by noting that, you know, the only time you can see where Germany has a 90% top tax rate is between 1946 and 1948, which is when the tax policy of Germany was set by the Americans. Okay? So this was... No, but I'm serious. This was the Allied Control Council, and in practice, the Americans that were setting the tax policy of Germany. And when the Bundesrepublik took its sovereignty back in 1949, they immediately reduced first to 75 and then to 50% because the Germans thought this is completely crazy to have 90%. You know, this is a crazy American idea. We don't want that. Now, you have exactly the same pattern in Japan. You know, the only year where you have a 90% top tax rate in Japan are 1946 to 1948. And, you know, the Americans were not doing that to punish the German or the Japanese, because they were doing the same at home at the same time. So it was, so in the American view of the time, you know, this was part of the civilization package, if you want. You know, you bring democratic institution, and at the same time, you bring the fiscal institution that can prevent democracy from becoming a plutocracy. This was, you know, a very strong belief at the time, and you know, I know that this can all seem very exotic to you and, you know, a very distant past, but, you know, I think this is part of our common history, and you know, I'm not saying that things are going to happen exactly the same way. I think nobody really knows, but, you know, I think all I'm trying to do in this research is to put this issue into this historical and international perspective. And because I think, you know, this can allow us to better understand some of the challenges of the future. So let me stop there.
So we have time for just a couple of questions. And thank you. I should say first, that was wonderful. There is time for just a couple of questions. If you want to step forward so we can hear them, that would be helpful. Leopoldo.
Come up.
Step on up.
Hello. So, well, thanks for your stimulating work. It's very nice to have an economist quote in Banzac. That's not usually the case among economists. Nevertheless, I have some critical comments. You speak about mainly progressive taxation.
Read that just a touch, yeah. It's catching.
Progressive taxation, right? But to put it in Marxist categories, we have, on one hand, the ruling class, on the other hand, the working class. And it turns out that the ruling class, they are the ones who make policies, including the tax rates. On the other hand, the working class, I mean, often we have unemployment as a discipline device, using the famous title of the paper of Stiglitz. Upton Sinclair used to say, referring to the working class. It's hard to make someone to understand something if his or her job depends on the fact he or she does not understand that. So how are we going to achieve the dream of liberté, égalité, fraternité?
Okay, well, thanks a lot for this question. You know, look, I think you're perfectly right. I mean, these things don't come naturally. You know, it takes fight, and it took fight, and it will take fight. I mean, it's not the ruling class has not always been in power. Otherwise, we would not see that kind of graph. So it's more complicated than just the ruling class is always in power. But I certainly agree with you that it in the past at least it took major shocks and major political events in order to make this kind of policy change happen. So in particular in Europe, World War I was really key. I think the Bolshevik Revolution also had a very strong impact on the evolution of policy. I can tell you, in France, the same political groups that were refusing to adopt the income tax in 1914, even with a tax rate of 2%, then in 1920, suddenly, they accepted top income tax rate of 60%, largely because the Bolshevik Revolution had completely changed the intellectual and political landscape, and a big part of the elite was starting to think, well, after all, maybe it's better to have a progressive tax than an expropriation. So I think, the history of taxation is not a quiet history. It's full of fight, it's full of sometimes revolution, it's full of... So it's not a peaceful electoral history. So this I agree with you. I would also want to make clear that I certainly don't believe that progressive taxation alone is going to solve everything. I think investment in public services, education, health is probably even more important. And also I think changing the way property is organized, changing the governance in corporations. I can tell you, these debates can change also more quickly than we sometimes believe. Look in Germany, well, I'm not saying this is a model of democracy in German corporations, but, at least workers' representatives have a number of seats in the board of large corporations. And apparently this does not prevent them from producing good cars. And, the fact that you have more worker involvement, so you have lower stock market capitalization. When you compare the stock market capitalization of German companies to US, UK, or even French, you have a lower Tobin's Q, as economists say. So the stock market value as compared to the book value is much lower, probably because shareholders are not the only owners of the company. You also have stakeholders, you have a representative of workers, you have the regional government sometimes, for instance, Volkswagen. But that's certainly not bad for productive efficiency. So the market value of capital and the social value of capital are not always the same. And I think changing the governance of companies, developing new forms of ownership, even in the education sector, nobody has been proposing to transform Harvard into a shareholder company. I'm not saying the way it's governed is perfect, but I'm just saying that this debate on the different forms of ownership and how to organize the ownership of capital, this debate is certainly not over. But in my mind, it comes together, it's complementary with progressive taxation of capital. It's not a substitute. Because progressive taxation of capital also produces transparency about ownership, which is necessary for democracy. In particular, if you want to be able to intervene in the board of your company, it's better to know who owns the company and to have more financial transparency in the accounts of the company. So, I think we should not make an opposition between progressive taxation and class struggle on the other hand. At first it takes class struggle, or at least social political fight, to impose progressive taxation. And progressive taxation and the transparency that comes with it is very much complementary to economic democracy, in particular in corporations.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Oh, hold on one second. Just looking around for so many people with questions, and let's see. Please, Alyssa, yes, please.
Thank you. I'm not an economist, and you've given me hope that I can read your book, so thank you. The question I have has to do with the way that the framing is. It feels like you're talking about national economies and national wealth, and I'm wondering if the big dips that correspond roughly to the decolonial period and the incorporation of developing countries into our national economies through the transnationalization of corporate and corporate wealth, how that story plays into this story of national economies and wealth.
Yeah, no, you're perfectly right. This is, in fact, I didn't have time to show you, but that there are some graphs about this, and in the book I talk a lot about the this international dimension of inequality, and indeed a big part of the decline in the wealth to income ratio of Britain and France between 1914 and 1950, 1960 has to do with the loss of their colonial empire and the loss of their foreign holdings in the rest of the world. So just to give you one number, you know, in the UK, in Britain, in 1913, 1914, the foreign assets that they own in the rest of the world are equivalent to 2 years of British GDP, 2 years of British national income. So it's almost one third of the total wealth of Britain. You know, the total wealth to income ratio of Britain is 6 or 7 years. And out of these 6 or 7 years of national income in wealth, 2 years are, in fact, the fact that Britain owns a big part of the rest of the world. In fact, France and Britain own so much of the rest of the world at that time that what they are receiving in capital income from the rest of the world allows them not only to have a permanent trade deficit, but to keep buying the rest of the world. So, you know, it's as if, you know, you are paying rent to your owner, and with the rent, the owner is buying the rest of the building, you know. So that's... So it's always painful to pay rent to your owner, as you know, but when it's at the international level, you know, it becomes really painful. And of course, this came with political domination. And so, you know, I think in economic models, capital investment in other countries is supposed to be a very smooth affair, you know, and a very efficient affair. But in the real world, being owned by another country is not as smooth. And I think... we should. As of now, we don't have examples of countries that own as much in the rest of the world as Britain and France in 1914. But we should not be reassured by that, because, you know, these levels were really extreme, and some countries, you know, are moving. You know, some sovereign funds in some countries are moving fast. I think these issues of cross-border ownerships are issues for the future and not only for the colonial era.
Okay, I think we're going to have to close there. Let me mention that the reception has, in fact, been set up in the atrium of the Student Union Ballroom. Before we thank our speaker, I would like to present him with a poster of his appearance. and we'll ship this to you. You don't have to carry it. It's in New York. And please let us thank our speaker for a fascinating.